All right, so my friends, please take your Bibles. Please take your Bibles, and would you turn with me to 1 Peter? I know on the screen up there it says 1 Peter 1:1. I will reference 1 Peter 1:1. But again, as we've done the last three studies, would you go to the end? 1 Peter 5. Don't worry, I'm not going to read the same verses. I'm actually going to jump into 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 1 in just a bit. As you're turning, by way of introduction, today we will be continuing our introduction to this wonderful book, 1 Peter. How we are starting our journey into 1 Peter is by looking at the first six words. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. This was a real dude. A real guy who struggled with real life events. We were talking about this in our pre-service time, prayer time with the teen and parents. Sometimes when we process the New Testament information and we read through these books and then historically, traditionally, we see pictures of depictions of events. And in our mind, we have these 12 apostles walking around with halos, right? These guys that almost could do no wrong. And we put them up on this pedestal. Well, I think as you walk through the New Testament, you find these are real people. Real life struggles. God apprehended these troubled people and did a work of grace in their lives. I will be very upfront here and tell you that none of you will be to the place of Peter. You will not be an apostle in that formal sense. You cannot be. Jesus chose those dudes, all right? In a secondary, very broad sense, you are an apostle in that you share Jesus with people. You are a follower of Jesus, but you will not be Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. Nonetheless, I love how the scripture depicts these dudes, these people, real people going through real struggles, real life events. And so for the last 3 weeks of study, we've been looking at the real events in the Apostle Peter. We've been taking snapshots of Peter's development. Jesus Christ meeting him on Galilee and saying to him, "Follow me, I will make you fisher of men." Okay, there was more in that statement than Peter gambled for. All right. "I will make you," Jesus says. From there, we find that Peter went through 3 years of one class after another in the school of hard knocks. At Galilee, in Caesarea Philippi, at the Mount of Transfiguration. He went through this school, classes in the school of hard knocks, in on the Mount of Olives, in the Garden of Gethsemane, in the upper room, in the courtyard. And you'll remember last week we finished out looking at this section of the making of God's man of grace by spending time in John 21. Peter, the low of the lows, he's given up. "I failed. I denied Jesus 3 times. I'm a nobody. How could Jesus ever use me?" Questions that I would presume most of us in this room have had at some point in our life. How could Jesus still use me? And so we've walked through what Jesus did in John 21 to show comfort and restoration to his man of grace. It's beautiful. This man, the low of the low, broken, and Jesus saying, "Peter, do you love me?" "Yes, I love you, Jesus." "Well, then feed my sheep." "Peter, do you really love me?" "Yes, I love you. You know that I love you. Feed my sheep." "Peter, yeah, but do you love me?" Broken, Peter says, "Yes, I love you. Feed my sheep." And so there's almost like this transition in the life of the Apostle Peter, right? He's going from this series of school of hard knocks into the school of literal, real ministry. God brought him to the point in his life where he was broken. He was needy. He knew he needed God's grace. And then there was a section of time here between the ascension of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, or between the resurrection and the ascension, when Jesus poured information into these apostles. He empowered them. He encouraged them. He comforted them. And then in Peter's life, we go from the making of the man of grace to the ministry of the man of grace. Brothers and sisters in Christ, that's where we're at today. We're going to take snapshots of Peter's life and the ministry that God gave him. And here's the conclusion we're going to see so clearly, I hope, in scriptures today, that every step of the journey of ministry for the Apostle Peter demanded what? Grace. God's all-sufficient grace. Not one day in the life of ministry of the Apostle Peter could he function on his own strength and his own power. He needed God's grace every step of the way. To make this super practical, this is exactly where we are. The making of God's man and woman of grace, but the daily ministry of God's man and woman of grace demands something. It demands humility and submission to God's grace. So this is the key idea we're going to develop today. Here it is. The ministry of God's man, God's person, particularly in the story, Peter, it demanded grace. At no point in the entire time here of ministry of Peter could he unhinge himself from God's grace. This ministry, lasting approximately 30 years in the life of Peter before he was martyred, this ministry had still its ups and downs. We're going to look at that today. But this ministry, God used Peter to do amazing things. But in all of this, I love this because, again, back to how we perceive Peter as some guy up on this elitist platform. Oh, brothers and sisters in Christ, that is not how Peter viewed himself. Please understand that. He viewed himself as a humble servant of King Jesus. And I want to prove that first by starting in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 1. We're going to circle around to this in about a year. But I'm going to introduce you to this now. All right. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 1. Peter and all of this explanation and all of this writing in 1 Peter brings us to chapter 5. The Holy Spirit brings us through Peter to verse 1. Peter says this, "So I exhort the elders among you." These are the leaders in Jesus' church. Then please note how Peter acknowledges himself. A fellow elder. Okay, he did not say a supreme saint. He did not say an elite elder. He said, "I am a fellow elder. I am a witness of the sufferings of Christ." Further, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. Time out. Where did he partake in the glory that will be revealed? The Mount of Transfiguration. We've already looked at this. He saw this Jesus glowing. I mean, and then he fell down. You remember this story? And he got up and was like, "Let's make tents." And Jesus, and then the whole story, God Almighty from heaven interrupts Peter and says, "This is my beloved son. Listen to him, Peter." Shut up, Peter. Listen to him. Peter says, I went through that, but I want you to know I'm still a fellow elder. Not some elite position here. Here's the command now. Here's the exhortation to pastors, shepherds, elders. Verse 2. Shepherd the flock of God that is among you. Okay, again, time out. What did we just hear from John 21 last week? Peter, do you love me? Feed my sheep. Now, what is Peter doing? He's passing this on to all of these elders in these churches with suffering people. Pastors, elders, shepherd God's flock. This isn't your flock. It's God's flock. Shepherd the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight, but be careful. Do not do this under compulsion, but willingly. As God would have you. Not for shameful gain, but eagerly. Verse 3, not domineering over those in your charge, but by being examples to the flock. Verse 4, and when the chief shepherd, I love that terminology. Peter right here is not saying, I'm up there in the church. Look at me, worship me, pray to me, any of that. No, he's saying, I am an under shepherd. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. This chief shepherd is the chief shepherd who in John 21 said to Peter, feed my sheep, Peter. So we get this glimpse of the ministry of the Apostle Peter in his writings that we'll get to in our study through 1 Peter. But what I want us to do today is just acknowledge that in this ministry, it demanded grace every step of the way. By the way, before we even step into this ministry, how do we know that Peter was going to have a ministry? I want to just jump into three quick passages. You can turn there if you want, or you can just listen. Because I absolutely love this aspect of the Apostle Peter. Before he denied Jesus, before the courtroom scene, or the courtyard scene, before the crucifixion, there are glimpses, as we've already looked at, where Jesus said to Peter, Peter, you are going to do my work. These are promises that he gave Peter. What are you talking about, Pastor Andrew? Well, in Matthew chapter 16, you remember the story. Matthew chapter 16, verse 13, Jesus says in Caesarea Philippi, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they said, the disciples said, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. Verse 15, he said to them, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter, as would be characteristic of this guy, talked. He replied, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Verse 17, and Jesus answered him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father is who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. The gates of hell being death, okay? Now, there's a couple different views of what this rock is. This could be Jesus referring to himself. This could be Jesus referring to Peter's confession of Jesus. Or this could be, if you take it in a natural sense, this could be Peter. Now, we understand how this has been abused, do we not? The Catholic Church has massively abused this. If you want to check how Peter would have processed this, just read through 1 Peter. Peter's not claiming to be the primary shepherd here. Peter's not claiming to be the chief cornerstone here, is he? Jesus is. But however you take this, verse 19 gives us more information. Jesus says to Peter, I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Okay, we're not going to dig into the depths of that verse right now. We're just going to acknowledge something very overview here. Somehow, in these statements by Jesus, Peter was promised that he was going to do something amazing. The church was going to happen. Who was going to be part of this? Who was going to lead into this? It was Peter. Peter would be the one leading this. I think this is further evidence. Obviously, we're going to see this in the book of Acts today. I think this is further evidence in the next text, Luke 22. Again, we've already looked at this. Where are we in Luke 22? We're in the upper room. Less than 12 hours, Jesus would be hanging on the cross of Calvary. Jesus has washed the disciples' feet. You remember the whole upper room scene. Peter has not yet denied Christ, and this was in the discussion, but you'll remember this. Verse 31 of Luke 22. Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demanded to have you that he might sift you like wheat. He's going to rock your world, Peter. But I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And then a lot of times we fly through the rest of this verse. I like to highlight this verse and land on the rest of this verse. What does it say? Jesus says, and when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers. What has Jesus just done? Peter, you're going to go through a deep, dark valley, but guess what? You're going to return to me. And when you return to me, strengthen your brothers. Okay, friends, what are we going to see today in the book of Acts? Peter obeying Jesus and strengthening his brothers, all by God's grace. I think there's one other promise of Jesus that we can see that is found in the text we were looking at last week. If you want to turn to John 21, very clearly we see this promise. John 21, remember Jesus, fireside with Peter at Galilee, showing genuine care, gracious restoration. What does Jesus say about Peter's future ministry? Remember Peter trying to figure all this out? Feed my sheep, Peter. Verse 18 of John 21. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will dress you and carry you where you do not want to go. So in our minds, we're like, what does that mean? Well, I'm glad we have verse 19. This he said to show what kind of death he was to glorify God. And after this saying, Jesus said to him, follow me. Okay, so what is this? Jesus at the Sea of Galilee with the Apostle Peter. He is prophesying something about Peter. Peter, you're going to live a decent life, okay? He says, when you get old, you're going to live a decent life. But something's going to happen in your life. You will be taken to a place that you do not want to go. What are we talking about? Friends, we're talking about the fact that Peter would be martyred for the cause of Jesus Christ. He would die. Tradition says that in 68 AD, Peter was crucified upside down for his Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Why upside down? He didn't want to be considered, he didn't even want to come close to thinking he was worthy of Christ who was crucified. Tradition also says, and this blows my mind, and it's hard to substantiate this, this is not in the scriptures, but some of the church fathers refer to this, that Peter, before he was crucified upside down, visibly watched his wife martyred for the cause of Jesus Christ. I could not imagine. What is Jesus saying to Peter in John 21? Peter, you're going to serve me all the way till your last breath. This is Jesus' promise. But he's brought him on this journey to realize that all of these prophecies of Peter are only going to happen on one account, the grace of God. You will not get there, Peter, on your own. I am going to bring you the whole way. And so then what we find unfolded in the life of the Apostle Peter is one snapshot after another through the book of Acts. We transition from Gospels into Acts. Peter, serving Jesus by Jesus' grace. All of God's grace. All of God's grace. One event after another. God reminding Peter, it's not all about you, it's all about me. So let's unfold this today, starting with the first snapshot. You can see this on your handout there. Through God's grace, Peter ministered for Christ by providing leadership for Christ's followers. If you would look in Acts chapter 1. The context here is, you're most likely very familiar with this. What's happening in Acts 1, well, Jesus had already risen from the dead. He had spent time teaching his disciples details about him and his gospel. He had just promised the coming of the Holy Spirit, the permanent indwelling of the Holy Spirit, launched off by what's known as Pentecost. God's Spirit poured down on His church. I mean, this is one of the historic events in redemptive history that is amazing. The Holy Spirit would come, and Jesus told His disciples to wait in Jerusalem for this to come. And then what did Jesus do? He was gloriously ascended up into heaven. Remember this? The angel said, "What are you looking at? Go back into Jerusalem," right? The angel says, "He will come like He ascended. He'll come back. In the meantime, you got work to do. Peter, go get busy. Get busy based on God's grace." And that's what we see here. But we see something happening then when these disciples went to Jerusalem. We pick this up in verse 12. Would you just look at verse 12? "Then they returned to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away." Verse 13. "And when they had entered, they went into the upper room where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew and Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James." Who's missing? Judas Iscariot. Dead. All right? There's 11 apostles of Jesus Christ. Now, the story is, now these apostles will be led by God to bring on a 12th apostle. Well, we pick up Peter's part of the story in verse 14. "All these were with one accord, devoting themselves to prayer." Well, actually, verse 15. Before we get to verse 15, though, notice what all the disciples were doing. So it was not just the 12 apostles, it was this group. Because it says there were 120 of them in verse 15. We'll get to that in just a minute. "Together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and His brothers." What were they doing? They were devoting themselves to prayer in the upper room. Okay? One quick note here as we walk through the ministry of the Apostle Peter. The most practical expression of dependence on God's grace is what? Prayer. I'm going to say that one more time. The most practical expression of dependence on God's grace is when you go to your knees and pray. Okay, if I could just kind of get up in our faces. I'm getting in my own face right now somehow too. I'm looking in the mirror. I cannot say that I am truly dependent on God's grace if I'm not on my knees praying. How can I say that I'm dependent on this God's grace when I won't talk to this God? I won't spend time with this God. Verse 15, here's where Peter comes into this story. "In those days, Peter stood up among the brothers. The company of the persons was in all about 120. And said, 'Brothers, the scripture had been fulfilled. The scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke beforehand by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus.'" So much here we could talk about. But for sake of time, I'll leave the rest of the story in Acts 1 and make this simple point clear. By God's grace, Peter was back in business for King Jesus. What'd you think with me on the last 50 days of his life? Peter, at the low of the low, having denied Jesus. Now, through prayer and spending time with Jesus, he stands up, leads the entire group of apostles and disciples, all of them, all of Christ's followers that were gathered here in this upper room. He stands in front of them and leads them. Friends, how did that happen? I would say one answer: God's grace. God brought Peter from the low of the low to now leading his church. What was Peter doing? Luke 22 tells us what he was doing after, and we've already talked about this. After you struggle and you repent, strengthen your brothers. That's what Peter's doing here. Let's look at another expression of God's grace. We're in Acts 1. Acts 2 is the story of Pentecost. I would venture to say that most of us in this room are fairly familiar with Pentecost. All right. If you want to kind of in our minds tag this to redemptive history, this would be the establishment of Jesus' church, the launching of Jesus' church. And who was the one that God used by His grace to launch this church? Well, you've got it figured out already. It was Peter. Would you look with me? I'm just going to highlight some of these verses. We're not going to read all the way through chapter 2, but please follow along in verse 1. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place, and suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind. You can't see a wind, but you can hear a wind, and that's what happened here. You can hear the effects of the wind. And it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. Verse 4, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues. These are tangible languages. As the Spirit gave them utterance. Okay, what's happening here? This is an event in redemptive history that blows our mind. Jesus is about to launch His church. God is about to launch His church. And through the Holy Spirit, He empowers these people to see this happen. How does Peter fit in this equation? Would you look with me at verse 14? So much more in this story that I'm going to give homework that you read this week. How's that sound? Verse 14, but Peter stood standing with the 11. I love this. Peter is standing now with the 11. Lifted up his voice and addressed them. And it wasn't just a lightweight little squeaky voice from coming from Peter. Listen to what he says. Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give ear to my words. For these people are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day, but this is what was uttered through the prophet Joel, and in the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit. Would you skip to verse 22 for sake of time here? Men of Israel, because we're focusing on Peter's words. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. Okay, in other words, you know it. He was here 50 days ago. All right, and sooner. All right, verse 23. This Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. I love that. You, crucified and killed by the hands of the lawless man, God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by death. I love this. Friends, where is this happening? This is happening in the Temple Mount. This is happening probably less than a half mile from the courtyard where 50 days prior, Peter denied that he even knew Jesus 3 times. And now he's standing up in front of thousands of those from the nations in Jerusalem. And what is he saying to them? You killed the Messiah. Talk about the overwhelming boldness to proclaim Christ that could only come by God's grace. Verse 32. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we are all witnesses. Being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, He has poured out this that you yourselves are seeing and hearing. Verse 36, let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made Him both Lord and Christ. This Jesus, whom you crucified, by the way. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Brothers, what should we do?" Verse 38, Peter said to them, "Repent!" By the way, what had Peter just gone through the last 50 days? Repentance. Repent and then be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Verse 41. So those who received his word were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. What is this? This is the launch of Jesus' church. 3,000 people from the nations, nonetheless. If you read through the rest of this, as you'll see in your homework, this is from the nations. 3,000 people from the nations, those in Jerusalem and those from the nations, came to Jesus Christ in saving faith. Then they were sent around the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what's happening here in Acts chapter 2. And here is a basic of basic observations. Who's the one that stood in front of these people and proclaimed boldly the gospel of Jesus Christ? Peter. The man who had denied Jesus 3 times. The low of the low. And God, by his grace, is using this man to launch his church. Let's continue looking at these snapshots of Peter's life. Acts 3 through 5, we see the establishment of Jesus' church in Jerusalem. We're not going to read all the way through 3 through 5. I guess you got a lot of homework this week. All right. But I will just kind of give some high points here in Acts chapter 3 through 5. A summary of, by God's grace, Peter healed a lame man and preached repentance in Solomon's porch and temple. By the way, what is everyone thinking when a lame man's healed in the temple? Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. This is the establishment of Jesus' people by Jesus' apostle. All right. What else happened? By God's grace, Peter endured arrest by Jewish leaders. Okay, an arrest that he did what in the garden to avoid? He ran from that arrest. Remember that? And now he's arrested for the cause of Jesus Christ. By God's grace, Peter confidently answered the Jewish Sanhedrin. We just spent some time in our prayer time talking about this. He's standing there answering the family of the high priest and all the moral and Judaistic elite in Jerusalem. And what does he say? I mean, you're like, wow, what are you going to say, Peter, to these people that have arrested you? Okay, would you look with me at Acts chapter 4, verse 8? What did Peter say to these people? Knowing that just 50 days potentially plus prior, they crucified Jesus. What does Peter say? Verse 8 of chapter 4. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed? Let it be known to you, all of you and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him, this man is standing before you well." Okay, quick time out. Did Peter take this opportunity and be like, "Yeah, look what I did. This lame man, he's out there running laps now. Guess who did that? Apostle Peter, just look at my name tag." That's not Peter's approach to this at all. What does he say? "Jesus did that. In the name of Jesus, this man walks." Okay, another timeout. A lot of timeouts in these readings, sorry. Fast forward to now.
how often these expressions, people claiming expressions of miraculous healing, how much they're using it now in 21st century to lift up them. Friends, all of this is about Jesus.
Verse 11, would you look at verse 11? This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. Verse 12, just vision this with me. Standing in front of the Sanhedrin and all the high priest's family, he says this, and there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. He's the Messiah. He is the Son of God. The boldness of Peter. Boldness empowered by one thing. God's grace. Further, as you develop chapter 3 to 5, read through chapter 3 to 5, you're going to see by God's grace, Peter prayed for boldness to continue to proclaim Jesus. Peter's a real guy. I would imagine there's a little bit of shaking, fear and trepidation before he stood up and talked to people. So how does Peter handle that anxiety before he proclaimed Jesus? You're going to find in chapter 4, he prayed. He prayed, 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 and God gave him boldness. By God's grace, Peter confronted a lying couple. You want a fun story to read in Acts 5. God is serious about the purity of his church. If you doubt that, read Acts 5. A couple that came and lied about things they had done to bless God's church. They came in separately. And what happened? They were buried in the back parking lot of the church. That's how serious this is. And who's the one that's questioning them? I'll tell you, the one who's questioning them is the one that at this point, probably months before, had lied about Jesus, even knowing Jesus. Friends, what a testament to God's restorative grace in life. Peter acknowledging his faults. That's the difference between Peter having lied about Jesus and Ananias and Sapphira. They wouldn't acknowledge their sin. Continue on the story. Peter, by God's grace, preached Christ in the temple. He just kept preaching. He was arrested for the cause of Christ. And I love this because then the angel released him. And what did he do? Not tuck tail and run. What did he do after he was released from prison? Went right back to the temple and preached. What a different story than what we find at the end of the Gospels where he's running and hiding. Now he's running to the temple to proclaim the name of Jesus. And how did all of that happen? By God's grace. The ministry of God's man demands grace. We continue the story, and for sake of time, I'm not going to dig all the way through Acts chapters 10 and 11. But I love this story because through God's grace, Peter ministered for Christ by advancing Christ's gospel to the Gentiles, okay? The primary recipients in redemptive history at this point of the gospel were who? Jews, right? People of Jewish descent. Not that others in the nations could not have received this gift of eternal life, but the primary audience for all of this unfolding in redemptive history were the Jews. Okay, this was this time in redemptive history. But something happened, and to summarize this story of Acts 10 and 11, through a series of events that included a vision from God about unclean foods declared clean, Peter was used by God to see this dude, Cornelius. Who's Cornelius? He's a Gentile centurion in the Roman guard. I love the irony here. He came to Christ in saving faith. This led to the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. This led to baptism for him and his household. What did this prove? God the Holy Spirit indwelt Gentiles, just like he indwelt Jews. I love this. Who did God use to advance this? God's man of grace, Peter. By the way, let us remember as we travel through 1 Peter over the next year or so, let us remember this. This is a book most likely written to suffering Gentile believers around the world. And God is using Peter to write this. Let's continue in the story. How else did God use Peter by his grace? Through God's grace, Peter ministered for Christ by strengthening Christ's people through writing. Not just preaching, but writing. God used his apostles to put together that book that you have on your lap right now. The Word of God. The Bible. As a legitimate apostle of Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit used Peter to write the Bible. Peter was specifically used to write what books? Not a trick question, really. What books did Peter write? 1 and 2 Peter. But then I want to invite you to another thought here. God used the Apostle Peter as the support for another writer in the New Testament. Who was that? John Mark. Who wrote Mark? Peter was the apostolic backing behind the book of Mark. By the way, what do you know about John Mark's life? He was a guy dependent on God's grace because he abandoned the gospel or abandoned first missionary journey from Paul and Barnabas. Do you not see a pattern here of God's grace, God's grace, God's grace, taking humble, needy people and doing mighty works through them? And so Peter writes this. If you want to look at 2 Peter chapter 1, just to kind of let us see here that this was what God was doing. Verse 12, therefore I intend always to remind you of these qualities, the ones he's just mentioned in 2 Peter. Though you know them and are established in the truth that you have, verse 13 of 2 Peter 1, I think it right as long as I am in this body to stir you up by the way of reminder. Verse 14, since I know that the putting off of my body will be soon, as our Lord Jesus Christ made clear to me, as John 21. And I will make every effort, verse 15 is talking about his writings, I will make every effort so that after my departure, you may be able at any time to recall these things. What is he saying? God the Holy Spirit, and this leads into this discussion, God the Holy Spirit is using Peter to write his holy word. Can we just let that sink in for a minute? This Peter, this previously uneducated Galilean fisherman, is used by God's grace as one of the 40 authors of written revelation from God. The Holy Scriptures. I mean, there's a lot of evidence of God's grace, but I think that's a huge one right there. The God took this man who had denied him three times, the low of the low, who had given up on spiritual life, and God restored his heart, and now he's writing to strengthen his brothers. Two other quick snapshots, and we need to wrap this up today. And this next one will be a snapshot that reminds us the reality that Peter was not Mr. Elite Saint. That he needed to depend on God's grace through not just the ups of ministry, but the downs of ministry. What are you talking about, Pastor Andrew? Through God's grace, Peter ministered for Christ by battling personal sin. Yes, Peter battled personal sin. What are you talking about, Pastor Andrew? Well, would you look with me at Galatians chapter 2? Okay, let's connect some dots here. Who's writing Galatians 2? Okay, through the Holy Spirit, it's Paul. And Paul is referencing the Apostle Peter.
But he shares with us some of the life of Peter, the struggles, the real life struggles of Peter. This is in line with the theme of Galatians. Don't be tied to the bondage of the Old Testament law, okay? Live by this grace. But the indication of the scriptures is that Peter was tempted by a sin. What is this sin? It was a fear of man over a reverence for God. Ouch! If I can just be up front right here, right now, that is probably the person standing in front of you, the greatest temptation of sin in my entire life. A fear of man over a fear of God. Peter struggled with this. He was anxious about pleasing people. It impacted his effectiveness for the gospel. This was a battle for Peter through his entire ministry, I believe. And I think we see this most clearly in Galatians 2. Would you look with me at verse 11? Paul says, "But when Cephas came to Antioch," Paul says this, "I oppose him to the face, to his face. I stood face to face with him and confronted him." Here's why. Because he stood condemned. Peter, the seasoned apostle from Jerusalem, was guilty of sin. And what sin? Verse 12, "For before certain men came from James, he was eating with the Gentiles. But when they came, he drew back and separated himself, fearing the circumcision party." In other words, fearing the Judaizers. He feared them. Verse 13, "And the rest of the Jews acted hypocritically along with him." Oh, so there's the apostle of Jesus Christ, Peter, acting hypocritically. Out of one side of his mouth, he's saying, "Embrace the nations." Out of the other side of his mouth, he's saying, "Live by the confines of the Old Testament law. Separate yourself from the nations." And Paul, by God's grace, calls him out. When he came up to Antioch, Paul withstood him to the face. I can only imagine this conversation. Paul standing in the face of Peter, and Paul saying, "You hypocrite." Verse 14, "But when I saw that their conduct was not in step with the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas before them all, 'If you, though a Jew, live like a Gentile and not like a Jew, how can you force the Gentiles to live like Jews?'" We don't find much in the scriptures about how the rest of this story developed. But I will tell you, I think it went fairly well. After this comes the writings of Peter, and you find in 1 Peter chapter 5, "Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God." You find Peter writing two books to the Gentiles among the nations. God graciously used Paul as accountability for Peter, to set him back on track with God's plan for grace and advancement to the nations. Okay, this is proof of what? Okay, here's the proof. As we talked about last week, one of the greatest expressions of God's grace is accountability. Grace is not unhinged from accountability. Grace embraces accountability. Catch this. Further, no one is exempt from accountability. Not even St. Peter. He was to embrace the accountability of brothers and sisters in Christ and the gospel of Jesus Christ. Practically, one of the greatest evidences of someone deceived and not walking in biblical grace is that they detest accountability. How dare you ask me that? Who do you think you are to ask me that question? How often do we all feel that way? Why would you ask me that? Friends, one of the most gracious expressions of God's grace are the tough questions about our lives. When I read through these struggles of the Apostle Peter, you know what it does for me? Whew. He's real too. Because I struggle through these same things. God has placed every one of us in this room with a commission, given each one of us a commission to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, to see disciples made for the glory of God. On that journey, here's the reality. We will struggle. Sin is a reality. Battles are a reality. But friends, one of the evidences of God's grace is who's sitting around you right now. Those that will come to you and say, hey, I got a bit of a question for you. And in grace and kindness, as we also find in Galatians chapter 6, in a spirit of meekness, we hold each other accountable. And this is by God's grace. One last expression of God's grace in the ministry of the Apostle Peter that I want us to look at today is this. Through God's grace, Peter ministered for Christ by persevering all the way to death. Martyrdom. We see this anticipation by Peter in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 14. We've already read it. I'll just read it one more time. Verse 14, Peter says, "Since I know that the putting off of my body will be soon, as the Lord Jesus Christ made clear to me." Remember, just as prophesied by Jesus in John 21, as we started our study today, history records that in fact, Peter was martyred for the cause of Jesus Christ. Crucified upside down, potentially watching his wife martyred for the cause of Christ. The words by the church fathers, and we don't know for sure about this, was that while she was being martyred for the cause of Christ, he was standing there encouraging her of the better life to come. This is God's grace. God's empowering grace. By God's empowering grace, this man who had denied that he even knew Christ three times, ministered faithfully for Jesus Christ till his last breath, some 35 years after the denial. Was this a perfect journey for the Apostle Peter? No. But we know this, that it was a journey saturated by God's grace. So what? I think to make this very practical, we ask this question to ourselves. As God is using you for gospel ministry, okay, we're talking about His eternal purposes. And like we talked of last week, if you are here, you are breathing, you are a Christian, you've placed your faith and trust in Christ and are indwelt by the Holy Spirit, God has a ministry for you. Even if it's going to your neighbor and saying, let me tell you about Jesus, God has a ministry for you. So as God is using you for gospel ministry, here's the question. Are you fully dependent on His grace? What does that even look like? We're going to find that unfolded through the book of 1 Peter. But here's some very good questions. How do I know if I'm fully dependent on God's grace according to what we looked at today? If I pray regularly, and again, this is not of works, but you know what happens? As I pray regularly and approach God's throne of grace in Hebrews, it reminds me that I need God's grace today. Do you pray? One of the greatest expressions, as we talked about all through this sermon, of dependence on God's grace is that you pray. How do I know if I'm fully dependent on God's grace? If I am motivated by Jesus' glory more than my own glory. How do I know if I'm fully dependent on God's grace? If I am proclaiming Jesus' gospel, not a more palatable rendition of my gospel. I want people to receive this word, and so I'm going to water down the gospel. That's not what Peter did. Again, if you question that, go to Acts 2, 3, 4, and 5 and see how Peter proclaimed the gospel of Jesus Christ. How do I know if I'm fully dependent on God's grace? if I am daily submitting to His plan and His purpose, not only for my life, but for the church. Not trying to create an agenda or a plan or a purpose that just seems to work better. God's grace and God's church is going according to God's program. Not what brings more people to the seats. It's what God says in His Word. How do I know that I'm fully dependent on God's grace? If I faithfully teach and preach and proclaim His entire words, not just the favorite text that I like a lot. The whole counsel of God. How do I know that I'm dependent on God's grace? If I'm obediently aligning my life to His Word, submitting every day to what He has written in His Word, not submitting to what the world says about me, but what God says about me. That is what it means to walk in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So as God is using you, my friend, for gospel ministry, are you fully dependent on His amazing grace? Through our study, all the way through 1 Peter, let us remember that God's ministry for God's people demands God's grace every step of the way. And so, God, that is what we cry out to You today. Let us, by Your grace, submit to Your mighty hand. You are building Your church. You're doing it in Your way, in Your time, with Your people. You, Almighty Father, demand humble submission to Your plan. So I pray today, Father, that You would give this congregation, Crosspoint Community Church, oh God, give us the perseverance to depend on Your grace every day. My friends here today, as we close in brief words of prayer and a benediction verse and head our way for the week, would you pray something with me? Would you pray that this week you would submit to God's grace? That you would submit to His purpose for your life and His plan for your life? Those people you want to minister, maybe even the ones sitting in your own row from your same family, would you pray that you would be dependent on God's grace and how you interact with them this week? As you go to work, young ones, as you go to school, young adults, that you would depend on God's grace. My friend here today, as you battle with that sin, that vice in your life, maybe a substance, maybe a response, maybe a substance that leads to a response, maybe a moral addiction, whatever it might be, would you ask God for grace to submit to His plan? Lastly, would you pray with me, brothers and sisters in Christ, that along with Peter, we would have grace to boldly proclaim Jesus to the nations? I'll close out our time in prayer, acknowledging the fact that there are several here, potentially, that maybe some of you here that maybe aren't as familiar with the story of the Bible and Jesus. I would just summarize it by telling you this. Every one of us in this room, every one of us in this world, were born into a sin-cursed, broken world. Why is that? It's because the first man created was Adam, and he rebelled against God.
from Adam's sin passed to the entire world. This sin that brings with it a price tag, and it's called death, eternal separation from God. Oh, my friend, but the story of the Bible is that 2,000 years ago, just as was prophesied for thousands of years, Jesus, God in the flesh, came to this world, lived a perfect life, went to the cross to pay for your sin, to give victory over sin. But the story of the Bible is that's not just something that's adequate to know about. The Bible compels those who hear the word to receive it by faith. This is a transforming faith that reaches into your heart. It's not adding Jesus to your life, it is making Jesus your life. Receiving Him as Savior and Lord of your life. And so, my friend here today, if you've never come to Jesus Christ in saving faith, would today be that day? Oh, don't wait. We're going to close with a verse in just a minute. If you have these questions, I would encourage you, don't walk out these doors without settling your eternal destiny before a holy God. That you would go from contend to death in hell to an heir with Jesus eternally in heaven. Oh, my friend, if you are struggling with that, please talk to me. Please talk to anyone around you that might be able to show you from the Scriptures how you can have hope in Jesus Christ. And so we come today, Father, thanking you for the time we could spend in your holy word, how sufficient it is to guide us. All things that we need for life and godliness found in your holy word and relationship with you. Please give us grace this week. Through the suffering, the pain, the uncertainty, the doubts, the real life struggles, we ask you, God, that you would continue to give us grace to depend fully on you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.